In this video, we'll talk about supracondylar fractures or fractures of the distal humerus. In children, the supracondylar region encompasses an area of thin, weak bone located in the distal posterior humerus. These are most commonly due to a fall on an outstretched hand. We call that foosh. Or even direct trauma to the elbow when it's flexed, and this kind of trauma and fracture may lead to neurovascular compromise. Let's talk about the supracondylar fracture classification. Extension type supracondylar fractures may be further classified according to the Gartland classification system. Type 1 Gartland fracture describes a non-displaced fracture with radiographic evidence of elbow effusion, and this is known by the anterior or the posterior fat pad signs. The anterior is also called the sail sign. Because the anterior and posterior periosteum remains intact, the anterior humeral line transects the middle third of the capitellum. Please take a look at this picture. As you can see, the line thrown from the humerus down through passes through the capitellum bone. Type 2 Gartland supracondylar fracture refers to a displaced fracture with an intact posterior periosteum. In contrast to type 1 fractures, the anterior humeral line is displaced anteriorly, either hitting the anterior third of the capitellum or missing it entirely, indicating a posterior displacement of the humeral fracture. In most children, the fracture line is clearly seen and hinging of the posterior periosteum, and posterior displacement of the distal fracture fragment may occur. Type 3 Gartland supracondylar fracture is a displaced fracture with disrupt anterior and posterior periosteum. This injury results in no continuity between the proximal and distal fracture fragments. Type 3 fractures may be displaced in three directions: posterior medially, the most common pattern, posterior lateral, and anterolateral. The direction of displacement is important, as it determines which neurovascular structures are at greater risk of injury with this kind of fracture. Supracondylar fractures are associated with form distal fractures in up to 5% of cases. And the combination of a supracondylar fracture with a forearm fracture increases the possibility of a compartment syndrome. For this reason, radiographs of the forearm should always be obtained if you have identified a supracondylar fracture. Prompt orthopedic consultation should be obtained in any but the simplest of supracondylar fractures, i.e. the type 1 Gartland supracondylar fractures. This is when there is no significant swelling, normal pulses, normal sensation, and minimal swelling. It is very important to know about one famous but terrible complication of supracondylar fractures, i.e. the Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Vascular injury and primary swelling from the injury can lead to the development of a compartment syndrome. That means too much pressure within the compartments of the muscle of the forearm and arm. This can happen 12 to 24 hours out. If a compartment syndrome is not treated in a timely manner, the associated ischemia or low flow of blood can develop into infarction, and this is called Volkmann ischemic contracture, where the elbow is flexed, there is pronation of the forearm and flexion at the wrist. This video summarizes the classification system of extension supracondylar fractures, the Gartland system, but it applies also to flexion supracondylar fractures, which are about 5% of all supracondylar fractures. These are potentially very serious, and the important thing is that the neurovascular status of that arm needs to be intact and the swelling be minimal, because it can result in this important complication called Volkmann's contracture, and that needs to be treated surgically and emergently. I hope you learned a lot. Bye-bye.